Good morning, students. I'm Dr. Somshekhar. Today we are going to discuss about spine. So, coming to the normal anatomy of spine, the spine is divided into four regions: the cervical region, thoracic region, lumbar region, and the sacrococcygeal region. There are a total of 33 vertebrae in the spine: 7 in the cervical region, 12 in the thoracic region, fusion with the ribs, 4 in the lumbar region, and 9 in the sacrococcygeal region. 5 sacral vertebrae, 4 occipital. So, what are the normal planes of the vertebral body or spine? During the fetal period, the baby acquires universal flexion position, that is nothing but flexion of all the joints, that is kyphotic deformity of the spine. When the baby is born, when the baby starts neck holding or baby crawls, they develops lordosis of the cervical region. Or when the baby starts sitting or starts walking, there is lordosis of the lumbar region develops. So what are the normal angulations of the lordosis and kyphosis of the normal spine? In cervical region, there is 20 to 40% of lordosis. In thoracic region, there is 20 to 40% of kyphosis, and in lumbar region, there is 30 to 50% of lordosis. So, why we need these angles? Whenever there is infection to the spine, or whenever there is trauma to the spine, there is collapse of some vertebrae occur. For example, in tuberculosis, there is collapse of vertebral body will be there. Or when there is any trauma, there is a fracture of the vertebral bodies. We can see formation of gibbous, that is kyphotic deformity of the spine. So when we do surgeries, we should not undercorrect or we should not overcorrect the spine. It causes unnecessary stretching of paraspinal muscles or the surrounding ligaments, which causes chronic dull aching pain in the spine. The vertebral bodies are made up of two types of bone tissues. One is cortical bone, which is the outer part of the vertebral body, which is dense, and the inner spongy type called cancellous bone. So, coming to the function of the spine, spine is responsible to keep the body in correct posture. It helps to maintain or helps in movements of the body like forward bending activities, rotations of the body. It also protects the spinal cord and the traversing nerve roots. It also protects the internal organs of the thorax and the abdomen. So, what is the functional unit of a vertebral column or a spine? It consists of two adjacent vertebrae and the intervening intervertebral disc and the posterior segments, which includes facet joints and the surrounding ligaments. Due to this functional unit, we are able to move the spine either forward or backward and the rotational movements. So, coming to structures of a normal vertebrae. We are seeing this vertebrae from the superior view. This is the anterior part of the vertebrae and this is the posterior part of the vertebrae. Coming to the anterior part, we call it as vertebral body. Coming to these parts, we also call it as neural arch. We see a pair of pedicles coming from the posterior aspect of the vertebrae. They continue as lamina. At the junction of this pedicle and lamina, we call it as ars interarticularis. There are 7 processes in the posterior arch. 2 transverse processes, 1 spinous process, and articular processes are 4. So this is the posterior view of a vertebra. These are the articular processes of a vertebra. 1, 2, and 3 and 4. So there are a total of 7 processes in each vertebra. When there is fusion of this vertebra, We call it as psychofacial joint or a facet joint. It is a synovial joint where the articular surface is covered with cartilage. So it is more prone for degeneration. These are the superior articular surface of the one vertebra, and this is the inferior articular surface of the same vertebra. So, what are pedicle notches? Or we also call it as intervertebral foramen. This is the inferior notch of the vertebra and this is the superior notch of the vertebra. When adjacent vertebra are aligned, we see a normal foramen, we call this as intervertebral foramen, through which the exiting nerve roots of this segment comes out. What is the importance of this intervertebral foramen? Whenever there is any fracture in this area, or there is disc prolapse, the prolapse disc impinges on the existing nerve roots, which causes dragging or shooting pain along the limb. So, what are the common ligaments of the spine? So, this is the anterior part of the spine, this is the posterior part of the spine. These are the vertebral bodies. Anterior to the vertebral bodies is a longitudinal ligament called anterior longitudinal ligament. It adheres to the anterior surface of the vertebra and the annulus part of the intervertebral disc. This is the posterior longitudinal ligament, which attaches to the posterior part of the vertebral body and the posterior part of the annulus. This is the intervertebral foramen. This blue color structure is called ligamentum flavum, or these ligaments connect both the lamina of upper vertebra to the lamina of the lower vertebra. These are the spinosus processes. In between the spinous process, we call these ligaments as interspinous ligaments. Coming to the posterior aspect of this spinous process, these ligaments which connect the posterior aspect of vertebra, we call it as supraspinatus ligaments. There is another ligament is there. This intertransverse ligament, where it connects the transverse process of successive ligaments. So, coming to normal arches of the vertebral body. The vertebral body is divided into two arches. One is anterior vertebral arch, the other is the posterior vertebral arch. Anterior vertebral arch includes body of the vertebra, that is whole body of the vertebra and one third of the pedicle. Posterior vertebral arch includes posterior two thirds of the pedicle, the laminae, pars interarticularis and the seven processes. So coming to basic vertebral structures. These are the cervical vertebra, these are the thoracic vertebra and these are the lumbar vertebra. As you can see, the size of the body, the vertebral body, gradually increases from cervical region to the lumbar region. So, what is the purpose? So, for preventing the axial load for making a damage to the spine or a fracture, the body of vertebra usually gradually increases from caudal to the subflex to the caudal region. And these are the spinous processes of each vertebra. We can see the spinous process of thoracic vertebrae is direct and is conical and is directed posteriorly. And these are the articular facets for the attachment of the ribs. Coming to the spinous process of the lumbar vertebrae, it is a spear-shaped structure and is directed horizontally. You can also see the articular facet of one vertebra, the thoracic vertebra, is 45 degrees inclined to the frontal plane. It allows rotation movements at the thoracic regions, whereas the articular surface of lumbar vertebra is perpendicular or it is in sagittal plane. It is responsible for the forward and backward movements of the spine. So coming to some atypical vertebra of the cervical region. First is the C1 vertebra or first cervical vertebra. We call it as atlas. The peculiar feature of this vertebra is it has no body. On the superior surface, we can see a superior articular facet which articulates with the occipital articular facet of the skull bone. This is the hollow place where the odontoid process of this C2 vertebra articulates with this C1 vertebra. So this is C2 vertebra, we also call it as axis. This is the odontoid process of the C2 vertebra. It arises perpendicular to the body of the C2 vertebra, where it lodges into the cavity of the C1 vertebrae, where it forms a pivot joint. Pivot joints is helpful for nodding of the head over the neck. Rotational movements of neck occur at this joint. So, coming to C7 vertebra, it is also called as vertebra prominence because it has the largest or longest spinous process of the cervical vertebra. So, coming to thoracic vertebra, the body of the thorax is heart-shaped. The cavity of vertebral foramen is oval or almost round shape. You can see this transverse process of the vertebra. It has two articular surfaces for attachment of the ribs. And this is a long spinous process which is directed posteriorly and downwards. The pedicles of this thoracic vertebrae are short in length. This is the lateral view of thoracic vertebrae. See the angulation of the articular facet. They are arranged 45 degrees to the frontal plane. So coming to the lumbar vertebrae, the size of the lumbar vertebrae increases from L1 to L5 region. These are the intervertebral discs. This is the intervertebral foramen. We call this as pedicle, which is broad and stout in lumbar region. These are the spinous processes, which is usually spear shaped. These are the facet joints or synovial joints or zygapophysial joints. So coming to the sacrum. Sacrum looks like an inverted triangle. It has sacral horns for articulating with the L5 vertebrae. This is the sacral alae. These are the sacral foramen for exit of the sacral nerve roots. This is the coccyx, which are 4 in number. You always mostly use. This bone defect is called sciatic hiatus. So coming to intervertebral disc. Intervertebral disc consists of two end plates, the central annulus fibrosis and nucleus pulposus. The discs are designed to accommodate movements of the spine, distribution of the weight, and acts as a shock absorbance in axial weight loadings. So coming to annulus fibrosis, the outer part of the intervertebral disc is called annulus fibrosis. They are usually arranged in lamina, like sheets, and it is usually made up of collagen fibers. The central part is gelatinous type due to more water content in it. It acts as a shock absorbent and resists axial forces. But it can be, when the axial forces are more, deformation of this area can occur, which lead to different stages of prolapse. Stages of prolapse become in later slides. So, how a nutrition is applied to the intervertebral disc? As there is no vascular structures connecting to the intervertebral disc, blood supply or the nutrients to the intervertebral disc occurs mainly through diffusion from the end plates, which are attached to the corresponding vertebrae, inferior or superior end plates. So, what will be arterial supply of any vertebra? This is the abdominal aorta. From the posterior aspect, we can see the segmental arteries, which branch as anterior and posterior spinal artery and intercostal arteries, where they anastomose each other and give vascular supply to the body and the spinal cord. So what is the venous drainage? In the cervical and upper thoracic region, both internal and external jugular veins drain the cervical upper thoracic region into the vena cava. Coming to the lower thoracic and the lumbar region, on the right side, the segmental veins drain into the esophagus vein. On the left side, they drain into the hemiesophagus vein. Both these drain ultimately into the vena cava. So coming to the spinal cord, it extends from foramen magnum up to lower border of the L1 vertebra. We call it a spinal cord, where it terminates as conus medullaris. It continues inferiorly as phylum terminal, which extends up to coccyx region. There are 31 pairs of spinal nerves, 8 in cervical region, 12 in the thoracic region, 5 in the lumbar region, and 6 in the sacrococcygeal regions. So, common dermatome innervation of this spinal nerves. Coming to C5, this is the sensory supply of lateral aspect of the arm. C6, lateral aspect of the forearm, thumb, and the index finger. For C7, it supplies the middle finger of the hand. C8 supplies the ring finger, little finger, and medial aspect of the arm. T1 supplies the medial aspect of the forearm. T10 lies at the level of umbilicus. So coming to lower limb, lateral aspect of the foot is supplied by S1 dermatome. Anterior and lateral aspect of the leg is supplied by L5 dermatome. Medial aspect of leg and the knee is supplied by L5. Medial aspect of the thigh and the anterior aspect of the knee is supplied by L3. So this is the overall sensory distribution of the body. So what are the common conditions we are dealing in the spine? One is cervical or lumbar spondylosis, one cervical and lumbar disc collapse, spondylolisthesis, and spinal canal stenosis. Today we are going to discuss about spondylosis and disc collapse. So what is a spondylosis? Spondylosis is nothing but degeneration of the spine. Degeneration usually occurs due to age, or it may occur in early stage due to any infections or trauma to that particular bone. Usually it involves the posterior elements of the spine and is more common in the lower cervical region. As it is age related, commonly seen is more than 40 to 50 years of age. So what is the pathogenesis? With advancing age, the hydration of the disc, that is nucleus pulposus, decreases. So there will be narrowing of the disc space, which causes extra stress to the facet joints and the surrounding ligaments. Due to repeated stress at the facet joints, the cartilage, since facet joints is a synovial joint, the cartilage degenerates, causes hypertrophy of the facet joints, and the hypertrophy of the surrounding ligaments. Due to chronic hypertrophy and the stress by the spine, the body develops, due to compensatory mechanism, the body develops bony protrusions like structures called osteophytes. We can see in this x-ray, these are the normal vertebral bodies. This is the posterior arch. This is the facet joints. This is the inferior surface of the superior vertebrae, and this is the superior articular surface of the inferior vertebrae. This is called as a facet joint. So we can see in this vertebrae, anterior bony projection surface are can be seen. We call it as osteophytes or bony spurs. We can see this is normal intervertebral space, but at this area we can see there is narrowing of the vertebral space and there is hypertrophy. We can see sclerosis of the facet joints. So this is the superior view of a vertebral body with intact spinal cord and the dorsal roots, ganglia and exiting nerve. Here we can see this is the annulus fibrosus and the central part is called nucleus pulposus. When there is a breach in the annulus fibrosus, the nucleus pulposus extrudes from the disc space. When it extrudes, it may or may not impinge a nerve root, which causes a chronic dragging pain to that limb. We can see a bony projection from the posterior surface of the vertebral body. We call it as osteophyte. This area is called intervertebral foramina. When the disc, when the disc prolapse is more, the disc may extrude at this area, which may cause nerve root, which may cause nerve root impingement. So what are the sequence? First, internal disc disruption, which causes disc herniation, which leads to decreased space, which causes instability of the ligaments and overloading of the facet joints, instability of the motion segment, which leads to chronic spondylolisthesis. It is nothing but anterior cropping of front vertebrae or the below vertebrae. The body stabilizes this deformity by formation of osteophytes and ligamental hypertrophy, which causes spinal stenosis or narrowing of the canals. Either it may be vertebral foramen or intervertebral foramen, which ultimately lead to spinal deformity. So what are the features of cervical spondylosis? The patient usually complains of chronic pain in the neck region, which may or may not radiate to the back of the neck, front of the neck, or the corresponding limb, upper limb. There will be diffuse tenderness on palpation of the cervical spines. There is limitation of neck movements. When the cervical spondylosis is more or the CVRT is more, sometimes it may compress the vertebral artery, and the symptoms of vertebral artery compressions include tinnitus, vertigo and blurring of vision. So by clinically examining the patient, we can vaguely diagnose which level or which nerve root is involved. For example, if a C-nerve root is involved, we can see sensory deficit at the upper lateral aspect of the arm and the elbow. There is deltoid weakness will be present. For C6 vertebrae, lateral aspect of the forearm, thumb and index finger will be present, and there is motor weakness of biceps muscles is there. For C7 vertebrae, there is sensory deficit of middle finger and motor weakness of wrist flexors and finger extensors. So by clinically examining the patient, without seeing an MRI or an X-ray, we can clinically find out which nerve root or which level is commonly affected. So coming to C8 nerve root, mostly the ring finger, little finger and the ulnar part of the palm is affected, and there is weakness of finger flexors and the interosseous. So coming to lumbar spondylosis, the same as cervical spondylosis, where degeneration occurs in the lumbar region. Depending upon the involvement of the existing nerve roots, neurological involvement may or may not present in cases. So when an L4 nerve root is involved, there is deficit at the medial aspect of the leg and the anterior aspect of the knee with weakness of quadriceps. When we suspect an L5 nerve root, there is anterolateral aspect of leg, there is sensory deficit will be present, and extensor hallucis weakness will be present. When we suspect a S1, there is sensory deficit of lateral aspect of the foot and the weakness of peroneus muscles, both longus and the brevis. So this is sensory distribution of leg, both anteriorly and posteriorly. So what is the treatment for spondylosis? Most of the spondylosis patients can be treated conservatively by giving complete bed rest, which is followed by physiotherapy or followed by muscle strengthening exercises of the back or paraspinal muscle exercises. So in physiotherapy, we can do shortwave diathermy, tractions. We can also give analgesics to the patients. So these are the common exercises of the neck region. So coming to when the conservative treatment fails, what are the options of surgical procedures? There are different types of surgical procedures for cervical spondylosis: anterior discectomy, posterior laminectomy and fusion, posterior foraminectomy and foraminotomy, posterior laminoplasty, or combined anterior and posterior procedures. Coming to each procedure, what is a discectomy? So what are the causes of a cervical pain? So what is the cause? The ultimate cause of any spondylosis is, one is age relation, other is trauma or disc collapse. So whenever there is a disc collapse, we remove the disc collapse by anterior approach. We remove the space, intervertebral space, we remove the whole of the disc. Sometimes we keep a bone fragment to maintain the intervertebral disc height. We usually take an iliac graft or any cortical graft, and we fuse these successive vertebrae with a plate and screws. What is posterior laminectomy? Laminectomy is nothing but removing a part of the lamina or whole of the lamina. So what is the purpose of this laminectomy or foraminotomy or laminoplasty? The sole purpose is to increase the area or volume of the vertebral foramen. In laminectomy, we remove a part of the lamina or one side or both sides of the lamina. Foraminotomy is nothing but opening of the foramina. Whether when the, due to stenosis, the diameter of the foramen decreases. In that conditions, we increase the diameter of the foramina, we call it as foraminotomy. When part of the wall of the foramina is removed, we call it as foraminectomy. What is a laminoplasty? Laminoplasty is nothing but reconstruction. Plasty is nothing but reconstruction. Laminoplasty is nothing but reconstruction of the lamina, where we remove a part of the lamina to increase the space of the vertebral column, and we fix with a bone or a screw. So coming to intervertebral disc. So intervertebral disc contributes 25% of the height of the vertebral column. It is common in the lower cervical and lower lumbar region. When it occurs in lower cervical region, it causes brachial neuralgia. When it occurs in the lower cervical lumbar region, it causes sciatic type of pain. These wraps may cause this root nerve root compressions. So, what are the classification of disc protrusion? Disc degeneration or disc bulge, disc prolapse, disc extrusion, and sequestration. What is a disc protrusion? The herniated portion of the disc is covered with a layer of annulus. So, annulus is intact. When there is an annulus breach, but the prolapse disc is in continuous with the parent disc, we call it as extrusion. When there are disc fragments or is separated from the parent disc, we call it as sequestration. Depending upon the extent of prolapse, the severity of nerve root compressions will be there. So, disc prolapse can be divided into central disc prolapse, paramedian disc prolapse, foraminal, and extraforaminal. This is the foramina where the nerve root exits. When the disc prolapse is more, it may extend till the foramina where it impinges on the nerve roots, which causes maybe a C5 nerve root compression, C6 nerve root compression, or L4 nerve root compression, or alpha nerve root compression. Most common disc prolapse is paramedial. So, what are the clinical features in a disc prolapse? There is constant pain in the low back or the cervical region with stiffness and muscle spasm, local tenderness from palpation, painful movements of the neck or the lumbar region, brachial neuralgia, or sciatic like features. So, for lumbar spine, there is severe backache on exertion like coughing or sneezing. Local signs include loss of lumbar lordosis due to spasm of the paraspinal muscles. We can test the patient with disc prolapse by SLRT or cross leg SLRT. What is an SLRT? SLRT is nothing but straight leg raising test. It is a neurodynamic test where we ask the patient to lay down on a couch. We ask the patient to be on spine position. We ask the patient to lift the normal leg. That is, we ask the patient to flex the hip with keeping the knee in extension. The same test is repeated on the painful side. We ask the patient to tell which angle is feeling pain. We note the angle. When the patient feels pain less than 30 degrees of hip flexion movements, the normal causes includes local pathologies like spondylolisthesis or any soft tissue infections in the gluteal region, like any abscess or any tumors in the gluteal region. When the patient complains of pain at 30 to 70 degrees of hip flexion, we usually confirm it as intervertebral disc prolapse. When the patient complains pain more than 70 degrees, we usually most common causes hamstring tightness. There are two types of tests. One is straight leg raising test and the other one is cross leg raising test. Cross leg SLRT is more accurate than a normal SLRT. In cross leg SLRT, we ask the patient to lift the normal limb or unaffected limb. When the patient feels pain when he lifts the normal leg, it is cross leg SLRT positive. It is more sensitive than SLRT. So coming to list is also called as sciatic scoliosis. Due to pain, the patient acquires a body posture depending upon the disc prolapse and the extent of disc prolapse and the site of the disc prolapse. So we can see in this pictorial diagram, there are two types of disc prolapse. One disc prolapse is lateral to the nerve root, that is away from the neural central cord, neural spinal cord and the nerve root. One is in between nerve root and the spinal cord. In this first type, the patient acquires the position, he tilts to the normal side. We call it as shoulder type of disc prolapse. In the second type, the disc is in between the nerve root and the spinal cord. The patient drops the body to the same side so as to relieve the compression of the ipsilateral disc nerve root. We call it as axillary type of nerve root compression. So what are the normal investigations? X-ray is common of cervical spine or MS spine. CT scan, MRI scan can also done. MRI scan is useful to detect other pathologies surrounding the spine, including soft tissue, disc, nerve roots, etc. So radiological features includes osteophyte formation, loss of disc space, sclerotic margins of the intervertebral regions. So what is the treatment protocol? We advise rest to the patient for 2 to 3 days along with NSAIDs, along with nerve regenerators like pregabalin and gabapentin. Exercise, we address exercises, either back or neck strengthening exercise, physiotherapy, lifestyle modifications. In chronic cases or which are not relieved with conservative treatment, we give epidural steroid injections 2 or 3 times at the compressed or prolapsed site. So these are the normal exercises we advise to the backache patient. So when we will do surgical management, when the neurological deficit is gradually increasing, or when there is failed conservative management, when there is deterioration of the neurological status, when there is involvement of bowel and bladder involvement, and when there is a sequestrated disc. Not always sequestrated disc is operated. Sequestrated disc with neurological involvement, we operate in the patients. So what are the types of surgery? Laminectomy, discectomy, without bone grafting, or without cage. Laminectomy is nothing but we usually do it by posterior approach. In this laminectomy, we first identify the level of disc prolapse by taking an MRI. After identifying clinically, we'll confirm it through an MRI. We pose the patient for surgery. In laminectomy, after reaching the lamina, we identify on which side. Through MRI, we can identify which side there is more disc prolapse. We can partially remove the lamina either on the left side or on the right side, or completely we can remove the laminectomy. Sometimes for a massive disc prolapse, we have to completely remove the lamina to reach the disc, where we can do discectomy. Discectomy is nothing but removing the disc in the intervertebral space. After intervertebral disc is removed, the hollowness of the intervertebral space is filled with bone graft or any steel cages. What is failed back syndrome? It is nothing but persistence of low backache even after satisfactory decompression. So, you will get a doubt. When a satisfactory decompression is done, why there is persistence of pain? Usually, post-discectomy, there may be infection of the disc space, or we may do any wrong level operations, or there is an aberration in the nerve roots. Sometimes, a C4 nerve root may exit a C3 level. Sometimes, a C4 L4 nerve root may exit at the L5 level. So this is called aberration in nerve roots. So treatment includes rest, medication and exercises. Exercises are mainstay of treatment both in spondylosis and disc prolapse. Whether patient is surgically managed or treated conservatively. So today we are concluding by these topics. Next we will come with spondylosis and spinal canal stenosis and deformities of the spine. For any queries, please send your queries to my email.
हाँ मैडम।